Good morning to everyone. Shall we all stand as we start our morning worship service? Let's turn to hymn number 14 as we sing the song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. All together on the first verse, ready, sing. Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever wilt be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. On the third verse, pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thy own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings on mine with 10,000 beside. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. For our next song, let us sing, Because He Lives. All together on the first verse, ready, sing.
God sent His Son, they called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives.
On the third verse.
And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll fight life's fight, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know He lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives.
May I please request Brother Rio Ben de la Cruz for our opening prayer.
Okay, let us pray. Our dear God and Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for the day that we can come to Thy house and worship Thee in spirit and truth. As we look back, Lord, in our lives, this past 364 days, we thank You, Lord, for all the blessings and for Your faithfulness to us. We pray, O Lord, that You will bless us as this coming year, that we can serve You more and win more souls for Thee. Bless this time as we worship Thee, O Lord. Bless the singing of the choir and as the message, as the preaching of Your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Shall we all stand and let us continue our worship through singing? If you have your hymn books, please turn to hymn number 54. Hymn number 54, as we sing the song, Count Your Blessings. Hymn number 54. All together on the first verse. Ready, sing.
When upon life's cost, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done.
You may be seated.
Well, good morning. Okay, welcome to Baptist Bible Church. It's the last Sunday of the year, and what a good way to end the year by being in the house of the Lord. Amen? Amen. As I've said, as we look back in our lives this past 365 days, let us reflect on what the Lord has done in our lives, and let us say, to God be the glory, great things He has done. Okay, so are you excited about what the Lord has stored for us next year? Amen. So let me just tell you what's going on next year. January 6th, first Sunday of the year, 2019, we're going to have our candlelight service. So we'd like to invite you to come in the evening as we have our candlelight service. Now in our bulletin, we'll be canceling our teacher and worker seminar. We'll be rescheduling it to another month, okay? And then the Lord's Supper, we're going to have our Lord's Supper on January 20. January 20. So if you have a pen, you can change the schedule there from 13. We're going to make it January 20. Okay, January 2019 will be our Lord's Supper, so everybody must be there. Okay, then our highlight for the year, January 27, our 70th anniversary. So let us pray that the Lord will bless as we have our anniversary. We're going to have our church service in the morning here, and right after that, we're going to have a lunch. Lunch will be served, and not right after lunch, we'll go there at the SMX convention near MOA Arena, and then we'll have our celebration of our 70th anniversary in the afternoon. So I guess that's all what's in store for us, and let's pray that the Lord will bless us, and let's invite our friends. We have some already flyers outside. You can get them, so you can invite our friends to come as we celebrate our 70th anniversary with the theme, God's Faithfulness, Past, Present, and Future. Okay, Pastor?
Okay, good morning. I'm so glad to see you. You know, does my heart good that I look out here and see some of you? You're always here. And that's a very good encouragement. Let me just mention a couple other things that we're having the reunion of members, our members here, members coming from abroad on the 25th of January. And so we want you to come. And it's going to be at the Shangri-La Hotel in Makati. And the price is $1,950. It's a time of meeting old acquaintance and talking to them. And you know, and I want you to please go. I think you would enjoy it very much. On our 27th, on our anniversary Sunday, you're not going to be able to fellowship so much because everybody's coming. Everybody's coming to church. We're going to have everybody coming here for that Sunday morning. I think we're going to be full and overflowing, and maybe we have to put some speakers down in the Tagalog room. I hope so, because many people will be coming. And so that is before, so we can fellowship one with another, people that you haven't seen for a long time. So I hope you can go ahead and get your ticket by next Sunday, and think about it, reserve that, so we can know exactly what we're doing. So that's exciting. Got so many things happening. We're busy. And so next week we'll be back in full force. We probably need to meet with all the men next Saturday or next Sunday after, right after church, for a few minutes because we need men for security. We need men for ushers. And some of you men are in the choir. You need to stay in the choir. You can only kind of do one job. And so a lot of things are happening. So I just pray that all things can work out smoothly as we try to do all the things that we really need to do. So we're excited about what's happening. And I hope you're excited also. Big day. First Church Baptist Bible Fellowship in the Philippines, started by Dr. Frank Hoagie, January 9, 1949. That was a long time ago. I was born then. Some of you weren't. And we still have charter members. So it's going to be an exciting time as we honor and really glorify the Lord today. Now, how many of you are visiting for the very first time? We had some. First time you're being in our church? Raise your hand real high, would you please? Okay, down here, over here. Okay, men, where are we? Oh, we're on vacation. That's what happened. Huh? So we need to help you, give you a packet from our church, okay? Members, you got to help, okay? So one here and some on the other side. Is that some others? Are you over here, first-time visitors? Please raise your hand high. Ben, over to the right, over here, okay? You members, you help there. we'll stand and sing our welcome song one to another and greet one another. If you need to move, please. If you're too cold, we'll move. We can turn them down, okay?
There's a welcome here, a welcome here. There's a Christian welcome here, hallelujah. There's a welcome here, a welcome here. There's a Christian welcome here. There's a welcome here, a welcome here. There's a Christian welcome here, hallelujah. There's a welcome here, a welcome here. There's a Christian welcome here. There's a welcome here, a welcome here. There's a Christian welcome here, hallelujah. There's a welcome here, a welcome here. There's a Christian welcome here. You may be seated.
No special. Wait. Okay, we have a missionary with us. I want him to come. Brother, come on up here. Brother Mapua, okay. And his wife, stand up. You want to come up here? Okay. His wife is Lenny. You remember Lenny that used to work in our church, married a preacher? This is her sister, her younger sister, right? Huh? And they're missionaries going back to Africa. And so I just want him to give a testimony so we could get acquainted with him a little bit. Okay, Brett?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Thank you so much, Pastor. Mayo buntag sa tanan. Maganda umaga po. Sorry kayo, Bisaya ko. My name is David Mwepo with my wife, my beautiful wife, Jonah May Mwepo. We are a missionary to Congo, Africa. I got saved in 2003 and baptized, and then I meet a missionary by the name of Dr. Felicida Felicidad. He's a missionary to Congo, Africa. He took me home, I stayed with him, and then until the time that God called me, I told my pastor about my call, but my pastor did not believe me that really God was the one calling me. So he wanted me to prove really if God's calling me. So he told me that I will not pay for your fare. Ikaw na lang mabay sa mga pamasahe. Ang pamasahe, mahal kayo. Mahal, mura mahal kita. So we were not able to afford until the time we pray for 2 days of prayer, and God answered my prayer. He provided for my fare. I went to Cebu. I studied there 3 years Bible college until I graduate, and they sent me back to Congo, Africa as missionary. Why Congo? It is God who called me to Congo, Africa. So I'll be going there together with my wife to start a church in the capital city where there is no Baptist yet. And then we'll also having a free Christian school where we can train and give free education at the same time. Disciple, mga Bible student, mga Bible student also, mga student. Like soon, the dream that we have for the ministry in Congo, Africa is so great. But it will never be done by just one man alone. But together with your prayer and your support, we can make it. Once again, salamat again for praying for missionaries, for supporting missionaries. I am the product of your giving. I am the product of your prayer. Thank you so much. May the Lord bless you. Maganda. Marami salamat. Also, thank you.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Christopher, where are you? There you are, Christopher. Yeah. From. Same countries, okay? All right, we're gonna have a special number, so at this time, let that special come, okay? Okay, where's our special number? Okay, Irvin, you have to sing a solo. Huh? All right, maybe she's not here. Okay, so we're glad each one of you are here today. The Word of God is still important to us. And on a personal note, I read the book of Job. And, you know, how many of you ever read the book of Job, right? You read it, and it's kind of confusing a little bit. And, of course, Job had sores over his body, and then he had three friends, and they tried to comfort him, but they didn't do it. They didn't know how to do it. And so I was just kind of intrigued about all the things that happened to Job. And one thing, all the things that happened to Job in his suffering and in people talking to him, trying to tell him how bad he was, and that's the reason that he is going through all this suffering. And Job kept saying, no, it's not. I'm not a wicked man. I'm not wicked. And so it's just quite an amazing story. And I'm just going to try to tell you the story and point out some things that we could learn from this. How many of you have had a trial this year? Any trials? Huh? Anything? I don't know what to do. Things happen to us. Yeah. All of us have some things that go through our lives. And Job, and the question is, why do godly people suffer? Why does godly people suffer? We're thinking we should not suffer. But we need to clear out one important thing. People are very quick to judge. You have a problem, you sin. You know, you're judging them that every problem is a sin. That's why you have the problem you have. That is not true. Did you hear me? Not true. You know, God does chastise his people. God does bring judgment on his own children that, like your children, they disobey. They don't do his will, your will. You spank them. You don't kill them, huh? You just spank them so they learn to do what's right. God, in his love for us, chastises us in order to let us know, hey, you're not doing right. You're not obeying me. You're not obeying the word of God. Then sometimes we are chastised in love, I want to say in love, so we could be a better testimony to the world as a Christian. People look at Christians, whether you know it or not, you say, I'm a Christian, I'm born again. Then you live in a glass house. You know what I mean by that? When you say, I'm a Christian, I'm born again, people back up and look at you, and they want to know if your life, what they think a Christian ought to be. There's no Christian perfect, right? Huh? We're not perfect, but we are different in our lifestyle because of following what the Word of God says. We need to obey and honor Christ. And so that's why people look at Christians. And that's why, by the way, so that's why some people don't go to church. They've seen a Christian and they commit worse sins than people that don't profess to be a Christian. And they say, well, if they're a Christian and they're doing that, why should I go to church? That's why our testimony that we have among people that I'm a Christian, I go to church, I love the Lord, should be, we're different people in our lifestyle in order to help people see that difference in our life. Then they say, I want to live like these folks. I want to live like them and be like them. And so this is a question. Why do people suffer that's godly? And so we're going to look at Job. So I'm going to try to read this and try to paraphrase some of it in order that we could get through the whole thing. In verse 1 of Job, chapter 1, and you know, it says, there was a man in the land of Uz with the name of Job, and that man was perfect, upright, and one that feared God and eschewed or hated evil. Perfect doesn't mean without sin. Perfect, that means that we are doing our best. We're not perfect, but it says he lived a life that people think, well, he's a perfect guy, and he's living his life like that. And so, and there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters, and his substance was also 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 she-asses, and a very great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men in the East. The greatest of all the men in the East. And so Job had been, over here it said God blessed him. Now, so he was a rich man. He had all he needed. He had plenty of things in his life. But still, verse number 4, and his sons went and feasted in their houses, every one this day, and went and called on their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. So they were just having a party, his family. Then in verse number 5, and it was so that when the days of their feasting was gone about, that Job sent and sanctified them, rose up early in the morning and offering a burnt offering according to the number of them all. For he said, it might be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus did Job continually. Here's a man that was really concerned about his family. If they sinned, he wanted to offer sacrifices for them. He wanted to show them that they should be doing that which is right. He was concerned. Every one of us, men, you should be concerned about your family and what are they doing, what's happening to them. And so we've mentioned that before. And so, but Job did. Now, verse 6, it begins with, we have a question. And there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, Satan came in also. You know, we know the story of Satan. I mentioned that not very long ago, that he was an angel and he sinned against God and God cast him to the earth. Satan is the god, little g, of the earth, the world system, and what's happening in our world of evil, ungodliness, and rebellion against God. He's behind all of that. And so Satan came. And so when he came, the Lord said unto Satan, "Whence comest thou?" Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down in it." And Satan, what's Satan doing? He's still walking up and down in the land today. He's still out to tempt everybody that is a child of God. Remember, he is your enemy because you are serving the true and the living God. He is your enemy. And so you're an enemy of him. And so he just goes around and see where is our weak things in our life. If we're not a strong Christian, we're weak in certain areas of temptation of sin, lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and pride. Those are the things that causes us to get into trouble. And so he's going down looking. He's looking at your life. He's looking at my life. He's looking at everybody's life that goes in a church, that carries a Bible, that prays, that does things like that. And so so he said he's been going up and down. And the Lord said to Satan, "Hast thou considered my servant Job?" Did you look at Job? He's serving me. He's living for him. He hated evil, as it said in this other verse over here. Verse 1, a perfect, sincere, honest, upright, and one that feared God. And he hated evil. He knew about Job, and he knew who Job was. And so, have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, perfect, upright, as he feareth God and hateth evil and cheweth evil? And so Job's testimony was very strong, that Satan knew exactly. Satan knows how strong you are. Satan knows your weak point, whatever that is, where you yield to temptation, you yield to lust or pride or whatever it might be. He knows your weaknesses, and he will always put your weaknesses right in front of you. Let me give you a simple illustration. I'm a diabetic. I love ice cream and strawberries and chocolate on ice cream. Don't put it in front of me. I am tempted to go ahead and eat it. Now, it's not a sin, okay? But you know what? Diabetics know we can't eat that kind of stuff. But you can still want that, right? You understand temptation? Huh? Have you all been tempted? You better say yes, huh? We've all been tempted that there's a desire for that, maybe, which is not right. And so, again, he said, look at Eve. And Satan said unto him, doth God, or Job, fear God for naught? Does God fear, Job fear God for nothing? For because God is his Savior, his Lord, watching over him. Does God? He questioned, why do we fear God? Why are you serving the Lord? Why are you living for him? And I want you to notice verse 10. Here is a promise for you and me. Hast not thou made a hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. Here we find that God protects Job, who feared him, served him, honored him. And Satan could not really do anything to him. Now, can I say a strong Christian that is committed and dedicated to God like Job, God has a protection and a hedge around us. Now, that doesn't mean that we still can't be tempted. That doesn't mean we still cannot fall into sin. But God has a hedge around us. You know, Bible says, there hath no temptation taken you, but such is common to man, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape. So any time that you're tested, if you'll look, there is a way of escape that God will help you out of your situation. Everybody's tempted, but everybody doesn't yield to temptation. There is a way out because God put a hedge around Job. And not only that, God blessed Job. Look at all the camels and all the things that he had. Multitudes, a rich man. God had blessed his efforts. That's why, you know, I believe that we need to pray that God will bless our church. We ought to make that our prayer. We ought to pray that God will help us to win people to Christ. That God will help us as we send missionaries around the world. Because we're trying to do this for God. Not for us, but for the Lord. So we need to pray. I believe we ought to pray God's blessing. God bless me today. God bless my family. God bless my church. Bless my children. Here they are. They might be a different place than you, a different country, a different place. But God, take care of my children. Bless my children while they're there. We can pray those kind of things. But aren't you glad that God does have a hedge around us? Why? We're his children. But as a parent, do you protect your children? You watch out for them, don't you? You protect them. You teach them. You train them. Be careful on this. We got the problem of bullying in school. You read about that, right? And so how do you teach your children how to stand up against people that would try to bully them so they could be strong? Learning how to defend yourself. Learning how, as a Christian, not to yield to temptation. Learning those things. But God has a protection for us. I like that. Then he says, he looked at God. Satan knows that he had a protection of Job. But put forth thy hand now, touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. Satan says, God, you take away all those cattle. You take away all of his riches. You take away all those things. He will turn around and he will curse you. Satan is always trying to get us to doubt that God is for us, that God is with us, that God will not fail us. He's always tempting us that we would not believe that. And here he is saying, God, you take all that stuff away from Job. He'll curse you to your face. Now, a challenge. Satan is always challenging us on what to do, right or wrong. Now, and the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power, and only upon himself put not forth thy hand. And Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. God said, Job is a sincere, honest, up man and hates evil. Say, Satan, go ahead. I'll give you permission to take all of his cattle, all of his stuff. And we'll see if Job will still trust God and live for God. We'll see. There's a test sometimes of our real faith in God. Our real obedience to him. There is a test that comes to us to make us. Why do you test? Strong. Become stronger as we are tested, as we are tried. The goal is to become a strong, strong, strong Christian in your house. Now, so let's see what happens, okay? And there was a day when he, in his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. And there came a messenger unto Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the asses feeding beside them, and the Sabaeans, another people, fell upon them, took them away. Yes, they have slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only escaped to tell all. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the fire of God was fallen from heaven and hath turned unto the sheep, and the servants are consumed them. I only am the one that escaped to tell you. And as he was yet speaking, it came another and said, the Chaldeans made out three bands and fell upon the camels and have carried them away, yea, slain the servants with the edge of the sword. I only have escaped. And yet while he was speaking, there came another and said, thy sons and thy daughters were eating and drinking in their elder brother's house. And behold, there came a great wind in the wilderness and smote the four corners of the house, and it fell upon the young man. They are dead. I only escaped to tell you. Boy, can you get that? He took away all his animals. His children were all killed. What would you think? Huh? What would you think if you were Job? Huh? Remember, Satan said, you take all that away from him, he'll curse you, God, to your face. He'd take it all away. Okay? Then Job arose. What was his reaction? And Job arose and rent his mantle, shaved his head, and it fell on the ground and worshiped. He worshiped God, even though he's lost everything that he has. His wealth, his family, he's lost it all. He did not complain. He worshiped and honored the Lord. What an attitude that he had. What an attitude that he had. Would you do that if you were Job? Would you do that? How strong are you? Would you begin to doubt God? Doubt the word of God? God's got a hedge around you? Would you begin to doubt that? Job did not doubt. He began to worship and honor the Lord, even though all that was taken away from him. And he said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And in all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. In all this, he did not say, God, why? How come you did that? You know, he did not get angry. He didn't get upset. He said, I came into this world naked. I'll go out of this world naked. Material things sometimes become too much for us. That becomes more important than God. It's sad when we lose the importance of worshiping and honoring God and living for God and let material things become important in our life, the most important. I remember a story I heard. A Chinese missionary in China, him and his wife, went on a preaching tour in China, left their house. When they came back, their house had been destroyed. His wife said, what are we going to do? He said, well, let's remember, honey, the furniture, refrigerator, all that, they are just things. They are things. And if we would look at our house, our refrigerator, whatever it is, and say, these are things. We can live without all those things. But we all like the things, and it's okay to have things. It's okay to have things, whatever it is. But you know what? We cannot put things ahead of God. We cannot put those things, whatever it is, ahead of God. We have to always ask this question. God should be number one. Do we put things ahead of God, and these become more important to us than being in church, praying, tithing, giving, witnessing, and all that? These things become more important than being in church. I had a member years ago. He finally bought a car. And he bought his car. And that's okay. Fine to have a car. But he took the car and drove it to the province and took it and drove it. And he had no more time to come to church. Well, it wasn't too long that he didn't have the car. If you put the car ahead of being in church and serving the Lord, that became a problem. So God said, okay, I need to take that car away from him so he'll still come to church and worship and honor me. You understand, 9:10, God takes thing away so we can go back and serve him. And so we like a car, we like all these things, and that's okay. But we cannot put them ahead of God. God should be number one in our lives. And so, but Job did not sin. He did not sin. Now, in verse number 2, and there was a day when the sons of God, chapter 2, verse 1, came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came in among them to present himself before the Lord. Satan is always around. He was in the Garden of Eden with Eve and tempted her, and she ate. Okay, Satan is always around. Now he is not like God everywhere at one time. There are angels that followed Satan when he was kicked out of heaven in Isaiah 14. So there are evil spirits that are in our world today, and they are also working as Satan works. He's in charge of them, and he's having them to tempt you and do things. So Satan is not everywhere at the same time like God. God is everywhere at the same time. So he's different. He's under God's control. And Satan said to the Lord, verse 2, said, from going to and fro on the earth and from going up and down in it, the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, and perfect, upright, as one feareth God and cheweth evil, and he hath holden fast his integrity, although thou movest me against him to destroy him without a cause. Satan moves against him to destroy Job, to destroy what he has. And Satan answered the Lord and said, skin for skin, yea, all that a man hath, he will give for his life. Now here's his challenge to the Lord. Put forth thy hand now, touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse thee to thy face. He didn't do it when he lost his children, all of his animals, all of his wealth and everything. He didn't curse God. Satan says, all right, you let me get a hold of his skin for skin. You get a hold of his body. Let me get a hold of that. That's what he's asking. And so the Lord said unto Satan, behold, he is in thine hand. Save his life. Satan, you can do anything you want to with the body of Job, but you cannot kill him. You cannot take his life. You see, if I think about it, I think that God knew the heart of Job. I think he knew the heart of Job. That he truly, 100%, loved God. How many Christians in different countries have stood to be martyred for the cause of Christ, even in our present world? There are people that are strong, and God is number one. I believe that God knew the heart of Job. Does he know your heart? What would it take for you to close your Bible, walk out of church, never come back again, never open your Bible again? What would it take? I hope it would say, never. I'll always be in church. I'll always open my Bible. God is always number one in my life. That's the strength that we need to have. Okay, when Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his foot until his crown. And he took him, Job took a potsherd or a clay thing to scrape himself withal, and he sat down in the ashes. How would you like to have boils oozing out of your body? That's what Satan did to Job. All over his body. He just took a thing and scraped to get the pus out and stuff like that. Okay? And so it's what he did. And he sat down in the ashes. Now, he didn't complain. There's no record of him saying anything. His dear wife, then said his wife unto Job, dost thou still retain thy integrity? Curse God and die. Curse God and die. Wives, you're supposed to encourage your husband. You're supposed to encourage your husband. She did not. Even Job's wife turned against him. You talk about being lonely. You talk about saying nobody cares. He smelled bad with all the sores and things on him. People would stay away from Job. What a thing that he went through. Job suffered approximately 1 year with the sores on his body. A long time. We get sick for a week. It's a long time. How about 365 days of having to live like that? Now, and he said unto her, thou speakest as one that foolish woman speaketh that. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God? And should not we receive evil? In all this did not Job sin with his lips. He rationed out. I've been blessed of God. I had so many cows, so many sheep, so many this. I had lots of money. I had many servants. I had so all these things. Good time. Rejoiced in the good times. Now, he said, should I receive only good and not evil from God? I don't know of anybody else that's ever in the scriptures that has ever suffered like Job has. I don't know of anybody like that. And so he did. Now in verse number 11, and when Job's three friends heard of all this evil, and they came upon him, and every one of his own place. Here's the three men. List that. And when they saw him, and they saw all, they knew that he had been lifted up his voice and wept, and they were every one his mantle sprinkled dust upon the heads toward heaven. They sat down with him upon the ground 7 days and seven nights. None spake a word unto him, for they saw the grief that was in him. They saw his grief. They did not say a word for 7 days and seven nights. I don't know why. Maybe they were astonished. Maybe they thought, I don't know what to say. I don't know what happened on this. And so then Job opened his mouth in chapter 3, and he began to talk about things. And I don't want to spend too much time on this, but I just want you to know that from chapter 3, and then these men would talk to Job and begin to reason out without God why he's being treated like this. And they wanted to say, because you sinned. Because you've done this and you've done that and the other thing. And they tried to offer condolence, but they could not condole it. And Job was saying that, I have not sinned. I still honor the Lord. I worship the Lord. I honor God. And I read all this last 2 weeks. And I thought, here is Job. All of his friends trying to comfort him. And they're not comforting him in any way, hardly any way. And when I thought about all these things that people said, and then Job would answer them, and he would talk to them and say, I am not sin. God is still my God. I never complained about God. He never rebuked God in any way whatsoever. He never did anything. He's always positive for God, the Lord, my Savior. He's the one for me. And I know God. I know all the way through. And so I kept reading, and I thought, why? Why? And God was simply testing Job. He was proving to Satan, there are men, women, that will stand true to God regardless of whatever happens to them. They will stand true to God. They will not turn on God and curse him. And they kept trying to give him reasons and talk to him and everything. And I'm not going to read all that, because you can read it, but it's this, the man saying, Job, it's your problem, and this is what, and that God is bringing judgment, and God is this, and God is doing that. These men did not even know God, but they were trying to analyze why Job was in the condition that he was in. And so Job, for 1 year, had this happening to him. You and I think that would be a century instead of 1 year. You know, so how do we compare this? You know, sometimes we look at ourselves and say, poor me, look at that guy, look at that girl, look at that woman, look at this and that, and compare yourselves. Let's never compare ourselves, because we always end up on the bottom. Other people are high. Here I am low. What happened, God? How come this? You know, that's why as Christians, our goal is to encourage each other. Our goal is to pray for each other. I guess the worst thing that we have is cancer. Let them know, people you know are Christians, have cancer. We can pray for them. They have other diseases. People have other diseases. We're to be the encourager. We're not to be the condemner. Because, as I said, all things of problems is not because of sin. Because testing, how much do you love the Lord? And God permitted Satan to have all those sores on his body from the top of his head to the sole of his feet. He could not hardly even stand. And so God is silencing Satan. God is silencing these men that came to console him. And he still would not curse God. He still loved God. He still honored God through it all. He did not. And so if we go back to chapter 42, go to the back. That's where it's in. Actually, in verse 40, Jehovah begins to speak. And he says, like Job, where were you when I hung the world in space? Where were you when I drew the lines of the waters? And how he created everything that was created? Where were you? Nobody was there. It was God that did all this that we have. And so, and finally, as he kept talking about how that all the things that God, and how great God is. In verse number 1 of chapter 42, and Job answered unto the Lord and said, I know that thou canst do everything, and no thought can be withheld from thee. Who is he that hideth counsel without knowledge? Therefore have I uttered all I understood not, things that were too wonderful for me, which I knew not. He's saying, God, you are an amazing God. I don't always understand. Saying things I can't, it's too wonderful for me to think about that. I knew not. Here I beseech thee, and I will speak. I will demand of thee, and declare thou unto me. I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, and now mine eyes seeth thee. He said, I've heard all these things, but God, I now see, I now know how great you really are. All the things. Then it says, wherefore I abhor myself, repent in ashes, dust and ashes. He said, I know I'm no good. I know that I need to repent. You know, when we begin to repent and really search our hearts for God to take care of us, when God, things happen to us. Job had 1 year to think about all the things, his life up to that point. And so he said, I need to abhor myself. I don't like myself. You know, we're still in the flesh, folks. We're still there. And we are tempted with the flesh, the eye, and our pride. Those three things we have to learn to control. You don't have to yield to sin. Now, verse 7, and it was so that after the Lord had spoken these words unto Job, the Lord said to Ephraz, the Temanite, and my wrath is kindled against thee, because thy two friends have you not spoken of me the things which is right, as my servant Job hath. All the conversations, they had not spoken about God. They did not know God. They tried to use philosophy. This is what's happening in our world today. Taking away the word of God as it really is and try to use, you know, politically, right? You know, don't be people. I have a friend that's got a couple of boys, and she says, they said, I don't want to go to church anymore. Well, why? Because the church is not giving. They're saying the church ought to accept homosexual, transvestite. The church ought to accept all the people that are living in sin and going against what the Word of God says. And the church condemns sin. God condemns those things, homosexuality, all the other things that's there. God condemns that through the Word of God. But today, the thinking of people, you're not against them. Don't be against those people. They're people. They have rights. They can do what they want to do. They can live their own lifestyle any way they want to. It's okay. I don't want to go to church that condemns sin. I don't want to go to a church like that. I want to go to a church that everybody's love. You know, God loves everybody. Everybody's going to heaven. Everybody. No, it's not true. They're throwing away what the Word of God says. They're throwing away the truth that's in the deep in the Word of God. And actually they're saying, bottom line is, you know what they're saying? There is no hell. Live your life the way you want to. It's going to be all right. No, it's not. There is a hell. There is a judgment from God. Read your Bible. Jesus spoke many times about hell. More than heaven. He talks about unbelievers. He talks about wicked. Romans 1 is what's happening in our world today. People lusting man after man, not man after a woman, no, man after man, women after women. And we're seeing God said, okay, I'll give you up. I'll give you up to your mind. Do your will because you've rejected you. You don't want my word. You don't want me. Go your way and live your life. They'll end up in hell. What a sad thing. Our world is coming today. They don't want to go to church that says you must be born again. It's sin to curse. Adultery sin. Things are sin. Robbery. All this is sin. They don't want to go to a church like that. Today, the world is fixing itself. I'll tell you what is going to happen. The rapture is going to take place. That will take place. But men today, look at people. Look at how people don't want you to condemn any sin whatsoever. And this friend of mine, she is so sad that her two boys said, don't want to go to church anymore because the church is too strong, too straight. They're not liberal like the rest of the world, that anything goes. My friend, don't believe that. There is a judgment. And unsaved people, wicked people, they will be judged and they will be cast into the lake of fire. The Revelation says that. That's what's coming. And God is a very patient God, and he's putting up with things and letting man try to figure out their own way, sin and that. That's why, church, you need to live a righteous life. You need to stand for what is right. Don't give in to things that are wrong, to be liked by people. Don't give in. Stand with God. Stand with the Bible. Be a Job. All his friends trying to encourage him and get him to go against God because they didn't know God. And they were using human psychology with Job. But Job did not listen. He knew God. You know God. You know what's right. And so God was against these people. Let me hurry on. He said, I want you to, he said, therefore, servant Job did right. Okay, verse 8. And they have taken unto them seven bullocks, seven rams, and go to my servant Job. Offer up yourselves a burnt offering, and my servant Job shall pray for you. For him I will accept. I will deal with you after the worst, after your folly, and that ye have not spoken of me the things that is right, like my servant Job. And so they did. And then verse 10. And the Lord turned the captivity of Job, and he prayed for his friends. And the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had. And there came unto him all his brethren, all his sisters, all that had been his acquaintance before. And they did eat bread with him in the house. And they bemoaned him and comforted him all the evil that the Lord did brought upon him. Every man also gave pieces of money, and every one eating earrings of gold. And the Lord blessed the latter end of Job. I want you to notice this. More than the beginning, he had 14,000 sheep. He had seven in the beginning. God gave him 14. And 6,000 camels, and 1,000 yoke, and 1,000 she asses. And he had seven sons and three daughters. And he called the name of the first was Jemiah, and the name of the second was Kizah, and the name of the third was Kinhap, whatever. And then all the land, there was no woman found as fair as the daughters of Job. And their father gave them inheritance among their brethren. And here's the blessing. And this lived Job 140 years. Saw his sons and his son's son to the fourth generation. Did God bless Job? He blessed him, didn't he? 140 years after that 1 year of suffering and never turning his back on God. He said, I'll give you double what you had. I'll give you 140 years to enjoy your children to the fourth generation. Does it pay to stand for God? Does it pay not to complain and gripe to God because I'm not blessed, I'm not this, I'm not that? God, you never gave me this. You get envious of other people because they're blessed? No, don't be that way. Say, I am going to live and I'm going to serve my God. He will be number one in my life.
number one in my life. I'll follow the scriptures. I will obey the scriptures. Friends might forsake me because I stand for the truth of the Word of God. But God is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. You don't need a brother that wants you to compromise and change your belief to go with the crowd. You don't want that. Maybe you're here today and you say, man, what a life of him. I want to know, if you died now, would you go to heaven? Or would you be honest with me and say, you know, preacher, I don't know. I don't know. Let me warn you, there is a hell. But there's a Savior, Jesus Christ, that we celebrated his birth, that died on that cross to pay for your sins. If you'll come to him admitting you're a sinner and asking him to forgive you of your sins and save your soul, you can have eternal life and you can be blessed of God. I want to warn you, if you don't and you reject Christ, there is a hell that awaits you when you die. I don't want you to go to hell. I want you to go to heaven. I want all of our people to be blessed. I want us to have a joyous life together serving God. Let's have our heads bowed. Just take an inventory of your own life in the past. That's the best way to do it. You don't look at your neighbor. Husband, don't look at your wife. Don't look at your husband. Children, don't look at your parents. I want you to look to God alone and say, what kind of a person are you? Are you one that say, I want to be like Job? God, I go through some small trials, but Lord, I want to be strong. I want to be stronger. And you can be stronger. You can be saved today. You can do the will of God and be a happy person. Father, I don't know the hearts of people, but Lord, what a lesson of Job for every one of us. Regardless of what happens, we still love you. And Lord, I pray for each person here. If you're not saved, I pray, God, that the Holy Spirit would speak to their heart and they'd say, I need to be saved. I want to know if I die, I go to heaven. For every Christian that say, Lord, help me to be strong. Help me to stand for you and the truth that's found in the Word of God. Bless this invitation, while we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Shall we stand, please? We're going to sing 333. If you need to make a decision for Christ today, unsaved friend, you come. We'll take the Bible, show you how to be saved. You're either saved or lost. How about it? Would you come while we sing?
Search me, O God.
You need to make a decision.
And know my heart today. Try me, O Savior. Know my thoughts, I pray. With my desire to magnify thy
name. One more verse. You need to come.
Have the ushers come and we'll receive the offering. We don't want to forget about our money that we have to pay for SMX, so let's remember that next week. Okay. One more. Yeah, Brother Fenner, come on. Come on. One more. Okay. Thank you for giving. Thank you for tithing. I know maybe you spent a lot of money, Christmas and all that. Let's remember the Lord. He needs to be first. Father, thank you for the privilege of giving, worshiping you, and honoring you today. Bless us, each one, as we give. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Shadow hard times, I wouldn't change that.
4 o'clock service this afternoon. Thank you for being here today. Have any our first-time visitors, would you please stand? And I want you to go at the back. And we have a VIP for you downstairs, very important people. You are first-time visitors. Would you please stand and go to the back? Members, if you're near them, you help them get up and go back. First-time visitors, don't be shy. We want you to meet you, get acquainted with you. Okay, there's three. Anyone else, first-time visitors, please go to the back, go downstairs, okay? Okay, I want to wish you all a Happy New Year, okay? Yeah.
Reminders are on the T-shirt. T-shirt for the anniversary.
Okay, I'm supposed to have them up here. We have some T-shirts for, that says, 76th anniversary. If they're in the back, they're supposed to be up here. If they're in the back, you look at them. They're $3.50. It's good to have one, remembering the 70th anniversary of our church. So, okay, here comes one handsome guy, I think. Yeah, he's handsome. Okay, all right. Probably you can't see it. Can you see that 70 there? We should have put lights on it. But anyway, we have this and we have red. And so we have 50. And if you want to order one, because we don't know all your sizes. And Carol is back there. Some other people help you. If you want to order one in your size, please do that today. Okay? All right. Okay. Thank you for being a model. Okay. All right. So we'll be back. Let's be here next Sunday. We'll have our candlelight service in the evening. And so that's always a great service. So thank you for being so faithful. You are a great group of people. We love you. And thank you for serving the Lord the way that you do. Okay. All right. Let's stand. We'll be dismissed in prayer. David, can you come up here and dismiss us in prayer? Shake hands with somebody that you don't know. Get acquainted with them. Our missionary. Here's our missionary up here. Okay. Is your name David? Oh, okay. Yeah, David number two over here. Sorry. Okay.
Let us pray. Our mighty God and Heavenly Father, this wonderful and great time for us to be here in the house of worship, O Lord, and we offer our thanksgiving for all the mighty things you have given to us, especially for blessing our family, respective places, O Lord, even our work and even the church, O Lord, and our dear pastor. O Lord, thank you so much for the love that you have given to us, even for protecting us, sparing us from different things. And even, Lord, I pray that continue to bless each and every one of us, particularly our own family and this church, O Lord. And I pray, O Lord, that many souls will be got saved. And even this new year, O Lord, we pray that continue to promulgate the gospel to each and everyone, especially use us, O Lord, for your honor and for sharing your word to those people who are not yet saved. Bless each and every one of us as we dismiss. All the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, Savior, give back the praises and glory. Amen.